Okay, tonight with us we have Giovanni Lombardo Radice. Giovanni, thank you so much for joining us.
Hi, everybody. I'm glad to be with you.
I'm going
to
say.
I before starting, I want to apologize for a couple of things. First is being dressed as on a beach, but it's really hot here in Rome. And second thing is that I'm smoking, which really I shouldn't be doing this. And I insist with young people, do not start. It's idiotic. But I started many, many, many years ago. And when I concentrate on something, I need smoking. So I hope you'll forgive me.
I'm sure everyone will. And I think it's pretty awesome that we have, to all intents and purposes, John Morghen with us this evening. We started off with a health warning. That's fantastic. Well, obviously.
Yes, but I didn't have an emphatic life, but since many, 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 many years, I'm very healthy. I mean, I just drink coffee and smoke and nothing else.
Well, that's a good thing. Well, obviously, you've had a very lengthy career to date, and there's still a lot of new things on the horizon.
Yes, I'm writing a book about my career, and I'm fully realizing just by writing how many things I did. Well, I'm almost 60, so. And I started very, very, very young.
Well, yeah, I mean, obviously I'm going to put some pictures in this interview so people can see, because we've got photos from you from very, very early on in your career. Indeed, from before your first film, which I guess is around about where we'll start, because your first film, or at least the first one we're aware of, because all the release dates seem to be the same, was House on the Edge of the Park.
Yeah, it was.
How old were you when you were...
I was 24, and it was my first movie, but I had been in showbiz and in theaters since I was 17. So it was my first, as an actor. Then before that, I wanted to be a ballet dancer. I studied ballet for many years. Then I injured my back, so I couldn't dance professionally anymore, even if I kept studying ballet until I was 40. So many, 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 many years, but I couldn't do that professionally. So I switched to theater, to acting.
Now, a couple of things about the choice film. Obviously, it's kind of documented, but although a lot of our viewers won't be intense horror fans, or at least not until after this interview, you weren't actually a fan of that particular genre of horror, were you, at any point?
No. No, you know, I... when I can say... I liked, as for one, I liked Hitchcock. Would you consider Psycho horror movie? I don't know. It's I liked Hitchcock very much. I like thrillers. I liked ghost stories, as well as I like different things. But no, horror, I mean, the last horror, and there were two milestones in my refusal of horror, and they were a Deep Red and Alien. Because I got so scared with both that I thought to myself, why do I have to pay a ticket to get an easy? So I just stopped. And no, I don't like gore. I don't like blood. I don't like unnecessary violence. So, you know, no, I'm not a horror fan. But that's different from being an actor in Hollywood.
Oh, of course, there's work, isn't there? It's a separate thing. But for perhaps the younger viewers who are watching this that maybe didn't come through, I mean, I'm 40 years old. As I was growing up in Britain, we had the Video Nasty sort of era. Mm-hmm. And for those of the our viewers who aren't aware of this, the impact of some of the films that Giovanni was in was absolutely huge on the horror fans of the day. Later on, certainly, I want to talk a little more about the Italian system that's, like many of the sort of studio systems, has gone by the by now. But these films, if you watch them today, some of you guys might find them not as sophisticated in some ways as the modern feature films, but what you're getting is something more visceral. These films were created by people on a shoestring, making films that did actually, in some way, change the world. And Giovanni's characters in these films were certainly key to that. In the first film, House on the Edge of the Park, it was interesting because the two main characters were so polar opposite, even though they were involved in the same horrible affairs. When you auditioned, did you get to meet David Hess at the auditions, or was it a film?
I didn't audition. I'll try to make a long story short, but unfortunately, after the war, fortunately and unfortunately, after the war, the entire movie system in Italy changed because of neorealism. What I'm talking about. It was a new wave of making movies based on reality and using street people and not actors. So on one hand, this produced a bunch of masterpieces, Bicycle Thief or many others. On the other hand, it destroyed the acting profession in Italy. So what was really important was just your looks. I did an audition, and it was a great shock to me. I was contacted that I had found an agent just a few weeks before that. She had found me, as a matter of fact. I had casually met her, and she said, would you be interested in being in movies? I was desperate about money, so I said, yes. And she was Ruggero Deodato's mother-in-law at that time, but I didn't know it. So he was preparing House of the Actors Park, and in a matter of maybe 2 weeks, I was cast. But no audition. He just looked at me. He was uncertain if I was to play Tom or Ricky. Then he decided for Ricky, and Michele Soavi had already been selected for Ricky, but he preferred me, I think, because of my English. And so no audition, and no, I didn't meet David until I started the movie. No. And I knew nothing about Cannibal Holocaust. I just heard something about a scandal, but I didn't really know about it, and I knew nothing about House on the Left, the Craven movie who inspired House at the Edge of the Park.
Of course, yeah.
So I was virgin. I arrived there virgin.
Well, I think that's a great part of the story, though, isn't it? That, you know, this sort of career was launched on just meeting Ruggero Deodato's mother-in-law. I think that's all. I never knew that. Thank you. Now, obviously, in that film, it's perhaps one of those films, in a way, much like the original Chainsaw Massacre, that is credited with being more violent than it actually is in terms of blood and gore. But it is an incredibly violent film.
In terms of sadism.
Yeah, I mean, in terms of sadism, it was certainly set, for want of a phrase, a benchmark.
But I rewatched it very recently with Ruggero because we were planning on making a sequel. So we watched back together very attentively, and he agreed with me that it was too violent.
I think that's very much of the time, though, wasn't it? You know, everyone was writing the Last House thing.
In my opinion, it was quite a good script with an interesting story, good characters, a nice twist at the end. What spoiled it was the unnecessary sadism, insistence on sadism as well as in female nudity. Not because there's anything wrong with beautiful girls naked, but if it's necessary. If it's not, it's just indulging.
Yeah, it certainly hit the exploitation term. I mean, one of the things that is fascinating about the film, once you get past the outlandish images of torture and brutality, is actually the two main characters. Mm-hmm. And in particular, your character, because although David's character was sort of very much evil incarnate up until the end, when he showed genuine remorse for at least one of his actions, your character was actually very different for that sort of film. In fact, for most horror films, in that there was a real duality of character going on. And regardless, most of those films were dubbed in the early days, it still comes through. Your character was obviously very conflicted between wanting to please David Hesse's character, and perhaps someone to, and also, you know,
being deeply honest.
Yeah, and that to me makes it much more interesting than why perhaps I might have watched it as a younger man.
As a matter of fact, I think, and David agreed with me, that our relationship was the most interesting thing in the story.
I have to agree 100%. As I say, the younger me would have been along for the extreme ride. But yeah, I did view it recently, and that was the most interesting thing. And of course, again, there's limitations with production and things of that nature, and of its time, that perhaps had that film been made recently... It was shot in 3 weeks. Had it been made recently and with the luxury of time and a bit of budget, I think, you know, that could have been certainly investigated a lot more. And it is the key standout of that film beyond all of the sadism and the graphic imagery.
Well, there was a class thing. It was, a complex movie. I mean, there were more than one level of lecture, you know, of reading it.
Of course, but being the way things are, most of that was overlooked simply because it was more extreme.
Yeah, of course, of course. But, you know, I think that when you watch back movies, you find something that you didn't find at the time you first saw them. Happened with me with Cannibal Apocalypse. Maybe we'll talk about it later. But time gives, you know, more meaning to things.
Well, yeah, it allows a little perspective, doesn't it? And I guess age and maturity plays into that a little
as
well.
That was the word I was getting at, perspective, yeah.
And I do think age and maturity, like I say, plays into it. Because back in the day when I was with the fandom scene and hanging out with John Martin, who's also interviewed you, for me, it was just an extreme experience. But we all change. The next film, I'm not going in the probably not the correct order, but that's not essential. The next film is perhaps a polar opposite in terms of character development. And it's one I'd like to sort of get out of the way a little, but we do have to talk about, and it's, of course, Cannibal Ferox.
Well, you have jumped two movies, but yes, okay, let's talk about it. Okay. It was a piece of shit.
This is why I wanted to get it out of the way a little.
It was a sordid piece of shit. In my opinion, there's a big difference in between fantasy, I mean, depicted fantasy, and the so-called reality that you pretend to depict. I'll try to explain it. A movie like, I don't know, Fulci's Gates of Hell or others are connected with fairy tales, in my opinion. They're the modern rendition of fairy tales, which, as a matter of fact, are in the original version, not the Walt Disney one, but if you read the Grimm's books, they're full of horrible things, horrible. I mean, if you read Cinderella in the original version, you'll find out that the birds peck out the eyes of the stepsisters. Or in other fairy tales, there's ghosts, there's the boogeyman, there's even skeletons rising from the tombs, and so. I think that zombie movies or that kind of horror is the modern rendition of fairy tales, and they have the aim of projecting out of yourself fears and, you know, nightmares, and thus getting them out. It's a liberating process. On the other hand, when a movie like Cannibal Ferox pretends to depict reality, jungle, cannibals, natives, and of course it's not reality, it's just that they want to titillate the worst instincts in people, I think that this is horrible.
I guess. Sorry to interrupt.
When I,
about?
You know, I thought it was horrible when I read it, when I read the script. I didn't want to be in it. And Lindsay had offered me not the leading role, but the friend who was just an interesting, weak guy. And I had played so many of them. So I said to my agent, because I was badly, as usual, I was badly in need of money. So I just told my agent, tell him it's either the leading role or nothing, and I want thrice the sum they're offering. And one part of me was really hoping they would say no, but they said yes. So I was stuck to it. And I thought it was horrible when I read it. I thought it was horrible when I was shooting it, and most of all, I was shocked when I finally got on the internet, which was 2000 maybe. Okay, can you hear me?
Yes, I'm just listening and paying attention.
I just heard a strange noise. I got on the internet, and it was a shock for me because I hadn't realized how huge the fanship was. I mean, sincerely, before that, there had been the John Morghen booklet and a few interviews, but I thought it was something not bigger than, let's say, fans of Stalin's mustache or, I don't know, something very restricted. And it came as a shock to me to see how many sites, how many reviews, how many, and fans started realizing that I had an email and writing me. I mean, I was submerged by a reality I hadn't realized it exists. But coming back to the point, I was shocked in reading some users' reviews about Cannibal Ferox, stating things like, oh, I like to watch women tortured. Yes, those bitches deserved what they got. You know what I'm talking about. So women get killed by men every fucking day, okay? And animals got tortured every fucking day. So I am ashamed. I made a statement on the internet at that time explaining my point of view and saying I was sorry about the movie. I didn't want to have nothing to do with it. But when I started attending conventions, my American representative told me that it was impossible not to sign Cannibal Ferox posters or pics or whatever. But believe me, each time I sign something connected with Cannibal Ferox, I make a funny but insulting commentary. Like I put a, you know, as in comics, something coming out of my mouth, and like how do you call it in comics when they
speech bubble?
Yeah, okay, that, and I write inside, I hate this piece of shit, kill Lindsay, I don't know, whatever, because I thought that the best thing to do about it was discussing it with people. I mean, explaining to fans why I hated it. Because I can't say I didn't do it, because I did.
Well, yeah, but you've got to eat. You know, it was a film. You're an actor. You got a part.
Yes. Yes. And no. It's no. Thank you, but no. Because if I am asked, if I had been asked even then, to make a movie, let's say, in glorification of Adolf Hitler, I wouldn't have done it. So there's boundaries. There's boundaries.
Again, that might be something that comes with age and maturity as well, though. to be fair.
Yeah, of course. I was 28. I was in bad need of money, and this and that. We all may make mistakes. I think it was a mistake. That only moving in, I don't know, 50, 60, I don't know how many I made in between, amongst, I mean, movies and TV series and stuff. I didn't count them. But okay, I did it. Some people like it. And so I think the best thing to do is explain why I hate it and discuss it with people. In my opinion, that's the best I can do.
I think a lot of the thing with the film, yes, you know, you mentioned those comments about, oh, I like to see women cut to pieces and this guy. A lot of that is a kind of bravado. It's the whistling past the cemetery. You know, young guys watching extreme things, listening to extreme music, saying extreme comments to show how extreme they are.
Yes, you know, I'm not stating that one watches a movie, then goes out and rapes and kills a woman and hangs her by her tits. I'm not saying that. But anyhow, movies can influence people. How can you tell that those guys in the United States getting a gun and killing an entire their schoolmates or, I don't know, 20 people weren't influenced by some very violent things they saw on the internet?
Oh, you can't deny that that's entirely possible. It would be impossible, wouldn't it?
I can't swear on it. I don't know because I'm not in their mind. But, you know, so I think that certain things should be avoided, basically, just to be on the safe side, you know, better safe than sorry, as the saying goes.
And I think with Ferox, and like I say, I don't want to dwell on this film too long, but I did want people to get how you feel about it. I thought that was quite important.
I'm glad to talk about it because I'm glad to explain my point of view about it. Also, I think I'm terrible in that movie. That's another thing I'm discussing with Hans. Oh, but you were great. No, I know. The character was as flat as a board. No insights, nothing. He was just a bad guy, full stop. And as I probably told you in private conversation, I mean, even Shakespeare has bad guys. I remember I was there in the Amazonas because first days I wasn't needed on set, so I was just in the hotel room just with the script saying, what the fuck am I going to do with that? And I tried to thought of Aaron in Titus Andronicus or even Iago in Othello. But for God's sake, the dialogue was by Shakespeare, not by Lanzi, you know, and it makes a difference. I didn't know what to do with the character. I just grabbed on the fact that he was a coke addicted, which unfortunately I have been for a few years in my youth. And so it was something I knew about. I grabbed on that. I was shouting all the time, overacting all the time. I mean, honestly.
You chewed up the scenery. You chewed up the scenery. But let's face it, what else could you do with the character? Let's be honest.
No. I agree with you, but I wouldn't say it was good acting. As a matter of fact, I think that every acting school should have a don't do it class, you know. Just don't do it on the door. So at don't do it class, I think Cannibal Ferox should be shown.
To be fair, this is how you act, having your cock cut off and the top of your head chopped off as well. Let's be reasonable. There wasn't a huge body of experience to pull from for you to act that part. I'm looking for something positive here. I'm doing my best.
I can't find anything positive about Ferox, I must say. It was very tiring to shoot. The location was terrible. In my opinion, if you're shooting in the Amazonas, you must be directed by Kubrick. And if you are directed by Lanzi, you should be in a 5-star hotel in the Côte d'Azur. And don't let the two mix. because land, sea, and the Amazonas is something really... the only good thing that I had some good company, because Lorraine was with me and she was a great friend, and we were bitching in French all the time. and there was Mino Loy, the producer, who was a very nice gentleman, and his companion, Fiamma Maglione, who had a small role, and she was the author of the music score. And so they were nice people, but I could have gone to dinner with them in Rome. No need to be in the fucking Amazonas.
Well, I think for me on Ferox, obviously it was an exploitative take on what Ruggiero had done earlier with Cannibal Holocaust, which was actually a very serious and well-crafted thing.
It's a copycat. Of course.
But of course, Lenzi did what he did best.
I never saw Cannibal Holocaust, but I'm pretty sure it was a copycat.
Yeah, I mean,
no, Lenzi, of course, was stating that it was a masterpiece in of a John Ford quality. But even if he pees, he says that it's a cinematic event. So,
well, I think the last word on Lenzi. I noticed, I think it was a couple of years ago, Quentin Tarantino came out praising Lenzi, and I couldn't help wondering. Did Quentin have access to films I've never seen of Umberto Lenzi's? I thought nobody could love Umberto as much as Umberto did. But apparently...
Quentin does? What?
Allegedly, he speaks very highly of him. But then again, Quentin Tarantino does odd things now and again.
Quentin Tarantino was a big deception in my life. So.
Really? Oh, dear.
Yeah.
Because friends and I were talking how we're surprised you haven't actually...
You know, these people talk. I mean, he made interviews stating that I was a great actor, how much he liked me in this and that. Okay. Then when Sage Stallone came to Rome and I made the commentary on the Laserdisc then, and then it was transposed to DVD for Cannibal Ferox, and It was a hit, because it's really hilarious, because he had Lenzi first and then me, and on two separate tracks we were saying entirely different things. So then by the way, Sage, God rest his soul, didn't give me a penny for that, and I think he made millions out of that commentary. So I lost track of my thoughts. What was saying?
That Quentin was a bit of a disappointment.
No, Quentin, no, yeah. And then Sage, after this never-ending thing of watching the movie, making the commentary, he told me, would you mind autographing something? Something turned out to be an entire... huge suitcase full of pigs, I don't know, just photographs and posters and even t-shirts. So I spent 2 hours signing, and was saying to Mary, to Lisa, to John, to George, to Quentin Tarantino, yes, to Quentin with love, and you know, and okay, he never made a phone call, wrote a letter, whatever. Each time he comes to Rome, you know, I'm not the one who goes there saying Quentin, I'm here. It's not me. Each time he comes to Rome, he only cares for MILFs like Edwidge Fennec or Barbara Boucher. I know. I think he's really into falling apart women or plastic teeth. So newspapers are full of Quentin went to dinner with Edwidge Fennec. Okay. And same with Eli Roth. Eli wrote me. Then they don't call you. So bye, Quentin.
His loss. There we go. Now,
I mean, if he calls me, I'll do it tomorrow. But I don't think he will, as Eli didn't. Eli even made a sort of remake of Cannibal Holocaust, even without warning Ruggiero. Ruggiero was pissed about it. Absolutely pissed.
I bet, because as we alluded to earlier, Cannibal Holocaust. I know you haven't seen it, but. Ruggiero actually had some very serious intentions. It was a serious film for him.
He did a cameo role in one of Eli's movies, and I don't want to state things. Okay, they are what they are. So, okay.
Yes. We'll move away from the now. From the early days, I now want to, and there's a reason I skipped these, my two favorite films from the start of your career, which were, of course, the first of which was Cannibal Apocalypse.
Yeah, my favorite too.
You played, I mean, it was a type of character that's very common now in broad strokes of the Vietnam vet who's troubled and tortured by what he saw, which certainly wasn't so much of a cliche back then, because that was like 1979, 1980, wasn't it?
80.
Was that an audition for that role?
No,
or?
Never.
Right, whose mother-in-law was it this time?
Believe me, I only auditioned for American or English directors. I never, ever auditioned for an Italian director. They couldn't care less. After a while, they know who you are because they have seen you in this and that. So, okay, never, ever for an Italian director. A lot of times for... Can you believe that I did four auditions for the role of Aliak Chang, the one who tried killing the Pope, Americans and English are professionals. After the first audition, I was paid for the other three. And then it was funny because I only have his cheekbones, but apart from that, I look like Aliak Chai as I look like to Queen Elizabeth. I mean, it's preposterous, but they insisted. So it was auditions with 4 or 5 pages, monologues. And then they said, okay, you're a fantastic actor, but your skin is white. Yes. So they started painting me, making me up in Arab. Okay. It's okay, it's wonderful, but you are blonde. I had blonde hair then. They dyed it black with a spray that was going away in a flash. And they say, oh, you're wonderful, but your eyes are blue. Let's try with contact lenses. And I say, guys, isn't it better if you call something someone else? I mean, it's not...
Someone of the correct ethnicity for a star, yeah.
So I auditioned for, I think, each important thing I did for an American movie or an English movie. Not, of course, not for young directors who were just honored to have me in, but not once for an Italian director. Your face is the right one, okay.
Well, wasn't that a lot of it with the dubbing, especially in the Italian films, even though you speak extremely good English, they didn't really care too much. They were going to dub you regardless. They just wanted to get the acting thing done.
Thing is, I can even speak a much better English if I don't have to think what I'm saying. It's virtually, because I learned 3 languages at the same time when I was born, English, French, and Italian. This makes a bit of a confusion in your head. And if I live in Italy and speak Italian, then I mean, I'm using English every day, but anyway, not living in UK or USA, it gets a bit rusty. But if I stay in one of those countries, let's say 1 month, then you can say I have an European accent or something. But and I'm very good also in making accents. I can do the Russian one. I can do the French one. I'm pretty good at. I have a very good ear. So no problem wasn't as for dubbing. Problem wasn't the English. Problem was that the dubbing was made in London. Shut up. Sorry, my dog. And the dubbing was made in London, and they didn't want to pay you to go to London. It was easier and quicker to do everything with English actors, you know? That was the main reason.
as an actor, did that used to frustrate you, the fact that, you know, part of your performance was taken away, wasn't it?
No, it did. It did, absolutely. Then for some of the first movies, I was dubbed even in Italian, because the fact of learning French at the same time as other languages left me with the French R, you know, which is something you English don't know about it, because only Scots pronounce R as the Italian and the Spanish and the Spaniards do. But I can only say as the French. So in Italy, that's connected to the to the aristocracy, to the upper class, and to gay people. I'm dubbing myself, and then dubbing doesn't exist anymore. I mean, it's all live. But I dubbed myself in many things in Italian. But at the beginning of my career, for those tough guys' roles, they didn't want my voice. So I was dubbed even in Italian. But as to be honest, as much as I always tried to do my best in every movie, just because I can't do otherwise. I mean, I just can't. If I'm acting, I even if I'm reading the telephone guide, I'll try. I do it at my best. So as much as I was doing my best, I didn't give a shit about those movies. It was just a way to earn money, to finance my theater activity, to pay my shrink. Dub me.
Yeah, just pay me.
Who gives a shit? I didn't give a shit, honestly. Honestly.
One thing, although your character in House on the Edge of the Park died, didn't die.
No,
sorry.
He doesn't die.
He just got injured rather badly.
Yeah. That's why we were thinking of a remake, a sequel.
Well, I did want to ask about that later, because we've got a couple of questions.
Yeah, it's the only one character I made that doesn't die.
Well, that's what it leads me on to. This, for me, Cannibal Apocalypse was the one that introduced me to the irrefutable fact of John Morghen. And I'm going to refer to John Morghen as slightly different character to Giovanni.
Yes.
The fact that John Morghen dies in terrible ways.
I swore to my cousin Leonello, who's now the head of the Morghen family, that I wasn't using the name anymore. But okay, John Morghen, yes. Because, you know, they were a noble family, and since he created, you can't imagine how many problems the fact that I used that name for those kind of movies. Cannibal, you were saying about Cannibal Apocalypse.
Yeah, that was obviously, as an aside, the first film where I discovered that John Morghen dies very badly in films, in the most most terrible of ways.
And that death was really scary. I was really scared when I shot it.
It was actually kind of a unique one as well, with the whole mechanical aspect of it. And just for the time, it was one of those. It was a real wow. I've got to rewind that.
But you know, it was very clever. People can see me in this interview, can they?
Absolutely.
Okay, so if I mime something, it's not lost. Because, you know, I was lying on a board, a wooden board, and there was the gate of one of the gates of the sewers. So I was hanging to the gate, and the upper side of my body was mine. But then from my neck was hanging a dummy of my body, very realistic, and the stomach was filled with explosive. So anyhow, the explosive was a few inches from my face, and I knew by experience and by stories that things can go wrong in movies. I mean, Brandon Lee died. Others lost an eye. Explosive is very dangerous. So I was scared. I was very scared. Also, wow. Because the special effect guy was, I did many movies with him, including Cannibal Ferox, and he is nicknamed Big Bomber. And now I think he's an old man. He was as crazy as a bat, jumping and excited, overexcited about, yes, let's put more. It was really scary.
It certainly made an impression on a young me. Anyway, and like we mentioned earlier, you know, the characters in that film, I mean, obviously you were starring alongside John Saxon, an established, well-known American actor.
Yeah.
The whole film was kind of different in feel to me to a lot of the other films that were coming out at the time. It didn't smack quite so much of the pure exploitation. It was like everyone was actually trying to genuinely make something really cool this time.
You know, as I was saying before, when I first read it, I just, oh my God, are they crazy? Are they saying that cannibalism is like a virus? I bite you and you become a cannibal? It's a spreading virus? I mean, boys, I mean, change your drug dealer because this one is ruining you. And I think it was utterly stupid. Then, when I watched it back, because of the many commentaries I did, because of the interviews, I realized that no. Not only it was very well done because Antonio Margheriti was a great professional, but it was stating that violence comes from violence because the whole thing started with the Vietnam War. So it was metaphorical. How does it go? Things, ill-born from evil get their force, or something like that. It's a Shakespeare quote. So it was metaphorical about violence coming from violence. Then, only I think 2 years after the movie, the AIDS epidemic started. So it was even prophetical. I mean, there were a few things that watching it now are quite surprising. And anyway, I've always been interested in my character. I mean, give me a good character with insights and acting material in whatever and give me some money, and I will always say yes. And that character was phenomenal. I mean...
Well, yeah, like I say, it just came across in that film that it was like... Although it was sandwiched, certainly when I got to finally view them, as you can imagine, this country, it was all on cheap copies of this, of that, and the other, and all mixed up time-wise. But it did seem very, very different to all the other sort of more exploitation-oriented Italian movies. It was like, yeah, they were trying to do something original, which was a huge thing, and yeah, fresh, and with actual characters in there. You know, they even spent time on the relationship with John Saxon and his wife. There was time for your character to breathe a little in it. And this was kind of unheard of in the horror films that were pouring out at the time.
And I must say that as much as Saxon hated the movie, he was doing it only because he was getting a divorce, and you know how divorces are in the United States. So he was in bad need of money, but he was hating every minute of it. But he was very good in it.
Well, you know,
in my opinion,
sometimes you need the money. To round up the very early years of your career, obviously, there's a film that actually, this one looms largest over my, I guess, childhood, because it was one of the few I was allowed to watch, which was City of the Living Dead,
mm-hmm.
Gates of Hell, as it was known elsewhere,
yeah,
probably several other names. Obviously not as large part as Cannibal Apocalypse, but no less the wonderful for it. Again, kind of a contradictory character in terms of, from the kind of films where characters usually are drawn fairly broadly, to be fair, the character in City of Living Dead was both gentle, perhaps sexually unusual, and again, just a very out-of-place character in terms of the genre as a whole, and kind of played in perfectly to the nightmarish feel of the film.
Yeah, you know, all three characters I played in my first three movies, which were House, Cannibal Apocalypse and CT. They had, I mean, they were all weak creatures, rejected by the world, depending on some man figure or some father figure. So they had things in common, and they had something I had in me at that time. I was very weak, very neurotic. I was anorexic. I had a lot of problems. So I think I gave those characters, which I must say are different one from the other. I didn't just play the same character, but I gave to all three of them something that was deeply mine. So as for Bob in CT, first of all, I refused. I was terrified about Fulci reacting bad to this, but on the first day in Savannah, I got to costumes, and they had a prop hunchback for me. I said, yes, can you wait just a few moments? And I said, no, I don't want to look like Marty Feldman or Frank Essinger. No. So I went to Fulci and said, Lucio, I knew him socially. I said, Lucio, say yes. And I said, sorry to disturb you, but I really don't think this hunchback is, I mean, it's too much. And can't I just slightly put my shoulders in a funny way and walk a bit, and he says, show me. And at that time, I was, as a personal study, I was studying Richard III. So I did a rendition of that, and he said, okay, no hunchback. Then he was talking with his assistant, and I overheard him just saying, maybe it was intentional that I heard that, but he said, and then they say theater people are no good. And so I escaped looking like the hunchback of Notre Dame. It was a big step. And then I probably gave him something that was deeply mine. You know, I am a fan of the Stanislavski method, not Strasbourg, Stanislavski, and I use a lot of zoomorphia. Zoomorphia is an acting technique based on studying animals and deciding what animal your character is. I always do this. So as for Ricky, it was a prairie dog, whilst Bob was a rat. And you know, when you do this, you really study the animals. You go to the zoo, you spend an afternoon there, you study them, you try to shape your body and to move, because when you find the body of character, 50% of the job is done. It's all in the acting, is first in your body, then in what you say. And so people at the zoo just like stare at you, like, you know, doing a prairie dog. And I don't give a fuck about what people think. Never ever. So yes, he was a rat. Bob was a rat.
What a pleasing one. And again, not that we're going to go into it. As ever, John Morghen died in an incredibly terrible and creative way. And that's as close as I'm going, I did promise. That'll do. Now, as when we chatted privately, obviously, we end up chatting for a long time. There are so many other things I'd love to get. We're not finished yet. There are quite a few things about what you're doing now I need to ask, but maybe we can pick up a part two of this at a later date. Because one thing a lot of people might not be aware of, they seem to think maybe you did those films and then nothing until recently. You've never stopped working.
No.
Not just in films and TV, massively prolific in theatre, directing, opera.
Acting, and I mean, theater has been, you know, the, in music, you say, the bar continues. I mean, I've done theater all my life. Recently, I just, I'm not doing it as too much, because, you know, in Italy, theater is based on touring, not as in London, that you just stay there. If it's successful, you just stay there for 5 years. No, in Italy, you just tour incessantly, and it's very tiring. I have two dogs, so I'm not so keen on doing theater now, but I did it all my life. I had a steady company for 15 years. I directed a theater for 15 years. And so I never stopped working. No. And I had a writing career for at least 25 years.
This is why writing, I think we'll have to definitely pick up on a part two. Because it just seemed we've only in nearly now we've only scratched the first 1 year of shooting pretty much. So, but I did want to talk a little about what you're doing now, because obviously, like I say, there was a huge amount in between then and now, including you know, small parts and things like The Omen and Once Upon a Time in America and all the things we've spoken about. But if we put it into, I think we'll end up with a 5-hour interview because I love to talk, I love to listen, and we just go on and on. But your recent things, obviously you mentioned at the start of the interview that you're actually writing your autobiography now. Mm-hmm. What's the title going to be?
The title I selected is A Zombie Life. Truly, I only played a zombie once with Fulci, but I think it's metaphorical. But, you know, as for titles, publishers, I mean, they have a word in it, so I don't know. It's, to me, it's labeled A Zombie Life in the file on my computer, but then we'll see.
And is it close to completion now, or...?
Yes. I think it will be finished by August.
Excellent. Well, obviously, I'll make sure everyone's kept appraised of how that goes, because I'll be mithering you on a regular basis as to its progress and when I can pick myself up a copy. So we got that to look forward to. Also, I did want to mention you appeared in Darren Ward's film.
Do you want to?
Go on.
A first?
Oh, look at that. There we go. A Zombie Life.
Can Fantastic. You see it?
I can see it clearly, yes.
Ta-ta, ta-ta.
Fantastic, thank you. A few years ago you were in Day of Violence, a film by Darren Ward.
Darren Ward.
Definitely
and,
a film.
As a matter of fact, Darren Ward is essential in this book because he's a great friend. And, you know, I think I write English quite well, but he's correcting my grammar bit by bit. I'm sending him every chapter. It comes back with I must say, a few corrections. But anyway, thanks, Darren, because he's essential in the process of writing.
Well, one of the reasons for bringing him up, obviously, that was a British film, which I'm all in favor of independent British movies.
So am I.
You were in it.
God save the Queen, by the way, and
absolutely.
welcome to Prince George.
Of course. And again, you got to die magnificently in the film, as is, I'm sure there's a contract somewhere that states this. But the main reason for bringing it up out of all the other work you've done recently, of course, is that come mid-August, Darren's going to be crowdfunding his next film, Beyond Fury, which you have a part in as well.
At a big part. Because you know what happened with Day of Violence? I liked the script enormously. I must say that MySpace before Facebook and then Facebook, it works much better than an agent. I mean, I got so many independent works there. I don't know why, because I have a site, my agency is on that site, but people prefer to contact me on Facebook, which is fine, because as a first step, I must read the script. So anyway, it's not worthwhile contacting the agency and the agency sending me the script. It's easier if I read the script myself. So I liked the script enormously. I cried. Can you believe it? And I mean, I've read a few scripts in my life. I cried. It was very violent, but okay. And the problem was that Darren was shooting that. Took him, I think, 2 years to complete it, because he was shooting it with friends, a small troupe, people who were working for free at weekends. So it was impossible to have me in a big role and flying me, you know, from Rome to Southampton weekly. I mean, it was crazy. So it had to be a cameo role, which I did with passion, because I love the script. When I met Darren, I loved Darren. When I met Nick Randall, I was mad about Nick Randall, who, by the way, is the most comfortable fellow actor to have naps on set, because he's huge. So you don't need a sofa. You just put your head on Nick. And he's perfect. And so we became friends. I visited him and his family. So, okay. Beyond Fury, he wants to make it on a professional basis. Not that Day of Violence wasn't professional, because it was. Great special effects, won a lot of awards in the world for special effects. But I mean professional, meaning shooting for 1 month or whatever needed. It's more expensive in terms of special effects, explosions, cars, and whatever. And so if he does it, as I hope he will, I'm having a very big role, a crazy gangster. And he wanted to name it with something, he wanted to name it with something that sounded Italian, and I say, Darren, why? I mean, it's let's do it Eastern Europe, because I can do the accent, and so I say, let's name it Lenzivich as an homage. And so Lenzivich will be the worst gangster you've ever seen in a movie. I want to play it. I want to play. Sorry. A crazy gangster, you know. Bigger than life. A bit in as Joker in Batman. I mean, not as so with heavy makeup and whatever, but with tacky colored clothes, like, you know, and purple or jewelry. Crazy.
Well, obviously, we're definitely looking forward to this. What I'll do, I'll make sure during the show and on LiveLeak we'll mention when his crowdfunding is due to start. Yeah. And I'll give people a reminder so they can check out and maybe kick in. Yeah. and help out with that. Yeah. Now,
but I have to say that Darren is great in. He's a great director and he's a great organizer, which, you know, nowadays you need to be.
Absolutely. You can't direct, wear one hat, can you?
No, but he's like a machine. He's wonderful. So I really hope he will succeed.
Well, there is just one last thing I have to ask. Most of the questions that were put to me, I've kind of rolled into the questions we spoke about. But there's one I did promise I'd give a special mention. It's about a project that's still listed as in development, and a user called Just Peachy. She's asked, is there any possibility that House on the Edge of the Park 2 may actually still happen?
You see, what happened was, I won't make names because I don't need to. Someone sent to Ruggero an idea for a sequel. Ruggero is not very familiar with English. I wasn't it. So he said, read it and tell me what you think. I read it. I thought it was disgusting. It was the most stupid thing I've read in my life. I translated it to him. I mean, we're friends with Ruggero. I mean, we see each other. We have dinner together. And we have a friendly relationship. So I translated it to him. He agreed and said, no, it's a bit of shit. Then he said, no. Skip it. I say, no, Ruggero, as a matter of fact, there's a possibility of making a sequel because I don't die, and do not die in this movie. So I said, why don't we don't want to do this, but if you agree, we can think ourselves of a different story. And the guy said, yes. So Ruggero and myself had a fantastic brainstorming session, more than one, as a matter of fact, like two kids, I mean, walking and smoking and eating and talking and, you know. And we, in a week, we came out with a treatment, very detailed, of a very good story, very good, which was as violent as people would expect, but with a lot of insights, a lot of insights about gay relationships, about class relationships, about a rich, spoiled woman exploiting a poor guy. I mean, a lot of things. The treatment was transferred into a very good screenplay. But then no money arrived. So there was this person, then another person, then a third, then a fourth. But apparently, the movie is a cult movie. I mean, but in a restricted, it's not the Texas Chainsaw Massacre. I mean, it's so as for now, it's stuck. What can I say? I hope, but it can't be postponed for eternity because we are stating that my character has been in jail for 30 years because of what happened in the first movie, just because he has been abused by a ward who managed to keep him in jail for years and years more than what expected. But I'm not getting any younger by the day, so I can't play Ricky at 75. So it's either it's in a couple of years or it's gone, I fear.
Fingers crossed something comes together. Giovanni, you know,
I talk too much. So
no, yes. Not at all, my friend. It's been an absolute pleasure. I wish we could just keep going, but even disk space would be an issue. But I gotta say thank you so much. It's been really genuinely interesting talking to you, and obviously look forward to everything you got coming up. And we'll mention the Kickstarter for Beyond Fury and anything else you might mention to me. And hopefully, can maybe talk again sometime about your theatre work and the thing. I know you wanted to talk about the correlation between violence and real life violence, things like that. Maybe we'll pick that up another time. I do hope you'd be willing to do that.
I would just say, before say goodbye, I want just to mention the very last thing I did, because the guy I did it, I was directed by, is a very nice person. He's Irish and his name is Dare McNabb. And I had a cameo role in a movie he's putting together, very much as Darren did with A Day of Violence, as to say, bit by bit. But he was very professional. He used a very interesting technique of improvisation. I didn't have a script. I just had a guideline to what my character was supposed to say, because it was a monologue of a dying man talking to his daughter. So I went to Dublin just for one day, and I did that, and I thought the guy is very, very interesting, so I wanted to mention.
Well, no problem there. Thank you for letting us know, and I'll get any information I can off you, and I'll link
Three
to his
Sisters.
Website.
The title is Three Sisters.
The Three Sisters,
As Chekhov's, but nothing but not to do Chekhov. With Chekhov. Yes.
Well, I'll put links in the upload of the full interview. I will link to anything I can so people can check that out.
Okay, it was a pleasure, and we just can talk on Facebook or wherever, and if you want more of this, as you know, I just love talking, as you can see, so it's no problem. I hate writing interviews. I get bored.
Well, it's half the fun, isn't it, talking and interacting?
But I, if I'm interacting with people, especially clever people like yourself, it's always a pleasure.